not allow us to meet the requirements from the VTS and capabilities of instruments. The major challenges were to bring it down in size and cost, maintaining high reliability, and meeting the dynamic requirements to VTS and alike. The required technology was emerging about 3 years ago. New microwave power transistors and sufficiently powerful processors were in the horizon. A project team of about 25 engineers and scientists was formed, and now, 3 years later, a total of 8 units was manufactured for test and verification purposes. The first new radars are in series production for delivery to customers later this year. Our next generation of radar series was based on the best from three worlds: the Scanner 2001, the Scanner 4000, and new solid state technology. A single wall mounted unit can now accommodate more processing power than two big racks could a few years ago. One performance goal was to meet and exceed the ILA-B128 recommendation, and also be able to configure to all three recommendation levels, basic, standard, and advanced. The radar does also come in a naval version, however, making it for shore-based application is in some aspects far more demanding than making it for ships navigation. Handling clutter in a high elevated radar, looking into the waves from shore to sea, is tenfold more difficult than when being low on a ship. Making it to work with antennas, having high gain and fine azimuth, the resolution further increases the requirements to dynamic behavior. The image here is from our factory test site. It includes two fast ferries in the picture. They're 412 nautical miles away from the radar. We transmitted less than 50 watt peak microwave power when doing that. Targets are detected to more than 25 nautical miles. The resolution is extreme and maintained on short and long range. We do mostly operate with 3 meter grain cell size in the entire range from less than 25 meter to more than 90 kilometers. Zooming in on a pole at 7 nautical miles gives this image, still with 50 watt peak power. And there was no radar reflector on this pole. The basic principles for this type of radar is, in engineering terms, relatively simple, as outlined in the paper. Making it work well is a different story. One of the major challenges is that interference from radars and other sources is a massive challenge to this technology. And we ended up transmitting numerous coded signals in subbands and extract the many signals of the reception. The amount of digital data coming out of the receiver is equivalent to playing a full DVD movie every 4 seconds. The processors handling this must be very powerful. They are very powerful. If you look into solid state transmission, then magnetrons transmit high power, typically many kilowatts, in less than 0.1% of the time. Our solid state concept transmits low power, but for up to 20% of the time. A mixture of long and short transmission ensures simultaneous short and long range coverage. The frequency diversity performance is improved by using up to 6 instead of 2 frequencies. We can also vary the power in sectors to further reduce illumination of built-up areas. This will reduce the cost associated with spectrum pricing, now becoming an issue in some countries. Coherence means that we know the amplitude and phase of signals during transmission and during reception. This is the base for pulse compression and for extracting Doppler information from the signals. However, there's also unwanted effects. Antenna side lobes is known in azimuth. By nature, side lobes will also occur in range in pulse compression radars. We do not suppress the side lobes. Side lobes are very low by design. This was one of the big achievements made by our engineers. Therefore, you'll be able to see a small target near a large structure. There are many other considerations. They are also handled. Offshore wind farms is, for example, no longer a special threat to radar coverage from this new technology radar. The radar cross-section of objects on a container terminal is enormous, yet we do not get any side lobes or other artifacts. We can almost separate the individual container stack. There's a Raycon at this terminal. It is too far away to be triggered by the 50 watts available for the time being, and Raycons are indeed difficult to trigger, as we just heard, with the low power levels, but easy to detect with sensitive receivers. What is worse, this unbalance and the listening to more than one signal at the same time is a risk. We may accidentally detect the same Raycon more than once in an antenna revolution and show false returns at wrong spots on the screen. We solved this and eliminated other artifacts by use of coded signals in sub-frequency bands. Back to the wind turbines, they do produce very strong signals. And as we see on this picture, the radars can detect without artifacts. In fact, the wingtip of a rotating windmill can be seen next to the tower itself. Lower right picture. The techniques do, in fact, also allow for full visibility of small as well as large vessels sailing through an offshore wind farm. We use the Doppler information, and we can easily get more than 30 dB improvement in some cases. That's a factor of about 1,000. But this is not beneficial for general surface surveillance. Getting useful information out of Doppler information require the targets to move towards or away from you, not tangential. Target movements must also be different from clutter movements. Those conditions are not applicable to marine targets in general. Detection of marine targets in clutter utilize pilot processing of signals from 1, 2, and 3 consecutive scans with benefits as illustrated by the blue curves. The Doppler information can, for example, enhance detection of hostile objects coming towards you. It can also enhance detection of helicopters and other flying objects. That's the green curve. I would be misleading my customers if I claimed more than 10 to 12 dB improvement in respect to detection of most marine targets. A major problem is that we don't have proper commercially available calculation tools for this type of radar. The commonly used tool Carbet can lead to very misleading conclusion if you don't have deep knowledge of the mathematics and mechanisms behind. Developing a new tool could be a task for IALA. Frequency diversity and time diversity gave us better range and much better performance in clutter than yesterday. For surface target detection, the main benefit of the new technology is further improvement in respect to detection of targets in clutter due to the extreme resolution.